I was watching this hearing and I was struck by the questions from both Democrats and Republicans about trade policy. You've also asked the chairman about trade policy. What did you gather about how the president's trade proposals are impacting markets?
Well, number one, there is certainly bipartisan concern, and I have called upon the administration to ultimately clarify what is their end goal here. If the end goal is to actually reduce tariffs, and this is merely a mechanism or a bargaining chip in order to do it, so be it. But when we look at the adjustment or the amendments to the Korean Free Trade Agreement, that's not exactly what we see. So I think what we heard the Fed chairman, on the one hand, the Fed chairman probably ought to stay out of fiscal policy. He kind of came in and out a little bit. But I think he agreed that, trade is a good thing. Trade is a win-win situation. No trade is a lose-lose situation. And I think it is clear that the chairman is not concerned today because, one, the magnitude of the tariffs have not been so great. The ripple effects have not been allowed to go through the economy. But I do believe, and he didn't say it himself, Kevin, is that, you know, you just see a dampening of the enthusiasm and the optimism, and there's no greater stimulus than business optimism. So I would say, to the extent the Fed chair indicated that he was concerned about anything, I would say the potential long-term effects of a protracted global trade war is clearly something he would be concerned about. I share that concern.
Yeah, I hear it every time I'm up in New York City about the political uncertainty coming out of these trade agreements and what that means for investors as they try to navigate through their portfolios. I want to ask you, Jobs Act 2.0, this just making its way through Congress, what is that going to do to alleviate some of the political uncertainty that a lot of the folks up here in New York City are concerned about?
Well, number one, it shows that Congress can still function. We voted this out of the House last night, 406-4. You know, a Mother's Day resolution wouldn't get a whole lot better vote than 406-4.
Don't tell my mom that.
And so, you know, fortunately, historically, as opposed to banking, you know, capital formation, particularly for entrepreneurial ventures, for small businesses, that's been something that has typically had some bipartisan support. So I was able to negotiate with my Democratic counterpart, and we had a very, very strong measure. We know that we're guaranteed that the Senate will take up this package of bills, and this is part of the JOBS, the acronym, Jumpstart Our Business Startups. Yeah. President Obama signed the first one into law, I believe it was in 2012, and then a couple of years ago we had Jobs 2.0. This is essentially Jobs 3.0, and it's far more robust. Out of the 32 bills in the package, probably 22, 23 have to do with capital formation, and it tries to treat, capital formation throughout kind of the whole ecosystem, rather everything from dealing with angel investors, broadening the definition of accredited investors, elongating the 404B Sarbox on-ramp, a very important venture exchange provision, because once companies do go public, we know that so many of these nano-cap and micro-cap stocks just wither on the vine, so this would allow the concentration of liquidity and hopefully bring in back the analysis and reporting of these companies. So I think it is a really, really good package of bills that will help provide for the Amazons and Googles of tomorrow. And now we just need to get all these boys and girls over my shoulder that way.
Mr. Chairman,
to pass it.
Mr. Chairman, let me ask you about foreign investment, though. There's some reporting. Sure. Is there going to be a deal next week?
Well, I believe so. So we have been negotiating with Treasury for ever since this bill came out of the House. And by the way, it came out of the House, I believe, 400-2. Again, a very, very strong bipartisan vote to both strengthen our foreign investment control laws, but to do it in such a way that doesn't harm foreign direct investment.
Because that's the concern, Mr. Chairman, is that that's
my legitimate concern. It's a very legitimate concern.
So you think that the deal next week, and I want to be specific here, you think it is going to balance those national security concerns with those of investors?
Well, one, I'm a conferee, and I don't think it can go through without my signature on the conference report, which is how our process works. So I'm reviewing the final language. I think that we probably ended up with a tentative handshake deal last evening. The devil's always in the details, so I reserve the right to actually read what people tell me they have agreed to. So we are analyzing the language right now. Again, I'm a little bit nervous. It's not quite as good as the House bill. I think it is far better than the Senate bill, but such are the you know, the negotiations between Senate administration and House. I think we do strike the balance. There are problems here. Clearly, we have to deal with our intellectual property and our critical technologies through hook or crook going overseas, principally to China. That had to be dealt with. There were gaps in what we call the CFIUS legislation or infrastructure, if you will. So we dealt with passive investments, minority non-passive investments. We dealt with real estate, but we also tried to scope it very as narrow as we can. I think we struck the balance. I mean, it's frankly, Kevin, something we always struggle with in Congress. How do you balance personal freedom, economic opportunity with national security? I'm pretty sure we hit it, and hopefully I'll be prepared to sign off on this conference report, as will my Senate conferees, and hopefully we can get it to the president's desk soon.